Good afternoon, everybody, and I feel rather strange, a bit nonplussed, because as a young aspiring art student in Lahore in the early 60s, we had two or three reference points in terms of artists who we felt defined people that we could look up to and defined what we felt would be the best teachers around us. And interestingly, Shakir Ali, who was, you know, very much modernist, just come back from the Slade in London, was a very prominent figure. But equally, there was Zain al-Abidin, who was very often in the hall, was a member of the Board of Governors, and in certain ways, more accessible, because he took it upon himself to work. For one thing, he used to come and stay at our house, so that's the concern. But he would take it upon himself to move into groups of students and just start out a conversation. There was a third towering figure of Abdul Rahman Chokhtari, you know, of the Lahore School, Ala Lahore School, who was totally inaccessible and would never come out of his painting studio on Rami Road. And if some brave souls would venture into his neighborhood and send a message upstairs saying that some art students would like to see him, he would peer out of the window and say, "I am not at home." So there was Shafi Sahab, and there was Zain al-Abidin Sahab, the two people who we felt could listen to our concerns and also very gently talk to us about their own work or things that they felt were important. But then there were the, what we felt were the younger strains coming through. There was Murtaza Bashir, who arrived in Lahore and was became, together with Mohin Najmi, a permanent fixture in all of the art discussions in the Arts Council. There were others who would be there coming in and out. Jahangir Sahib was among them. And so many who one encountered in the exhibitions, the national exhibitions. Perhaps the person who I wanted to grow up to be was Noghera Ahmad, who was this enigmatic person, a sculptor who wore black always and was very remote but always present and would nod quietly as she moved through the exhibitions. When I think back, it seems like I was living in another time, and of course it was another time. But one was not tremendously conscious about needing to think about an interaction between what was then East Pakistan and what was West Pakistan, or two regions of the subcontinent, because there was a kind of intermingling which went back to a time which was before 1947. Today we find so many of these works in some of the public collections, and of course there are references constantly to the influence that they had. I think especially of the fact that somebody like Zuhoor Al-Akhlaq, who is arguably the most important person from where we begin the story of the contemporary art of Pakistan, who spoke to me not once but several times of the influence of Kibriya on him. And because, as he put it, everybody else was looking west, but Kibriya was looking to the east. And the fact that he had spent time in Japan and that it was reflected in the way that his art was made was something that had a profound influence on Zuhoor Al-Akhlaq. And of course, we look to Zuhoor as perhaps the major figure from where we trace the beginnings of contemporary art in Pakistan. All of this as a kind of a framework. But Farooq, you were in a, in a different channel, I would say, which was much wider than our rather small art world in where I was, Lahore. I want you to talk a little bit about how you have seen it disperse, grow, come to a complete stop, and then perhaps commence again.
Good afternoon, everyone. Salima, as you have no doubt figured out, is a very hard act to follow. To begin with, I have serious questions about why I find myself on the stage. So I have to grapple with trying to justify that. One good reason possibly could be that the two young people sitting alongside Salima and are her products from Beacon House University and the Fine Arts Department, which Salima heads. I had the privilege of selecting them to go to Beacon House. And not only that, but in Aisha's case, I also had to convince her parents that this was a sensible thing for their daughter to be doing. I'm delighted that things have worked out in the right direction for both of them. So this, to me, is a good example of something I've believed in firmly, which is a South Asian cultural identity, to see South Asia as a kind of melting pot, and which it was when we certainly look back before 47 and look at the cross currents in the world of art and culture, whether it's music or whether it's in the field of painting. Salima referred to Zainul Abidin and his influence on artists, and similarly I could say that there were a number of people here in Bangladesh, or the then East Pakistan, who were influenced by people like Chughtai, and I would even draw similarities between the works of Kamrul and Sadiqan, and the lines which both of them excelled in producing in a matter of seconds. As someone who went to school in what is Pakistan, in fact, Salima, I don't know if you're aware, but Ijazul Hasan and I were in Aitchison together. And I always thought, in school at least, that I was a better artist than he was, except that he is today one of Pakistan's best known artists, and my job is sitting on the stage here talking about him. The two things I thought I would perhaps like to mention, one is, so happy to see Syed Jahangir with us, because it's figures like him that kind of straddled the two wings when in the pre-71 period. We had a number of artists who went back and forth, and I would say that I personally know of quite a few people who had collections of Bangladeshi artists. Kibria in particular was extremely popular, as indeed were some of the other big names, Syed Jahangir, Zainul Abidin, Murtaza Bashir, and there were even people who had a special taste for Rashid Chowdhury, Sultan, and Shafiuddin. All three of whom, incidentally, can be seen in the Rewind show, which is one of the special features of the Dhaka Art Summit. So, part of the effort through the South Asia Foundation and their scholarship program was to try and revive this cultural interaction and mix. Full marks to Salima and Beacon House because this South Asia Foundation scholarship attracts students from across South Asia. I should also mention, and this was an initiative which goes back now more than 35 years, I had the privilege of collaborating with Sayed Jahangir, who was at that time director of the Shilpakala Academy, in organizing the first Asian Art Biennale here in Dhaka. And one of the ideas, certainly as far as I was concerned, because I was at that time also involved in writing the concept paper for SAARC, the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation, was this quest for a South Asian identity, the ability for all of us, notwithstanding the divided borders, at least to be able to come together and agree on certain things and enjoy each other's culture and our shared civilization. So.
Before we go to our current generation, because I'd just like you to put, you know, into some terms of reference together, because we have images, we have traces of influences, and I'd really like you to, as a, you know, historian of modern art in South Asia, to talk about, you know, how these connections and how you see them now and how you're tracing them back in time. Yes, I picked out some of the images that are they're actually from my own collection, and this was run back in here, of course, as you can tell. This is from the collection of Nehru Dada, the architect in Lahore. I think the fact that Kibria's work was found to be really extremely engaging at a time when practitioners, younger practitioners in Pakistan, were looking for ways of engaging with what was happening in other parts of the world, but trying to do it on their own terms. And Kibria came as absolutely a revelation because you were being able to unburden yourself with so many of what were considered to be the essentials of approaching the body, history, with all its connotations. And he seemed to be able to suggest it and shed some of these burdens with great ease, which is why I think he was embraced with great fervor. Next, we can have some of the other, would you like to? Yes, this is the work by Muntaza Rashid. It's from the exhibition, the last exhibition he did in Karachi, which is called The Wall. It's also from my collection. And Faiz Ahmed Faiz inaugurated this exhibition at the Karachi Arts Council. And when 71 happened, Murtaza was unable to get his works back to Dhaka, and they were subsequently just disappeared from the Arts Council. And so I tried my best, and so did my father, to try to retrieve them, to find out what happened to them. So this seems to be the only work that is known to be there in Lahore. This is a work, this is the first painting I ever bought, and I'm terribly proud of it. I was an art student. I had just taken part in a play on the stage, an unheard of thing at the time, and I'd earned 300 rupees. And Murtaza was having his first solo exhibition at El Mamra. This was the work that he did in Italy, in Florence. And this work was for 500 rupees. So I took my measly 300 rupees and I approached him and batted my eyelids. I had longer eyelashes then. And I said, you know, I have 300 rupees. So he took the 300 rupees and the painting is yours, and it hangs over my mantelpiece in Lahore. And he came to Lahore in 1986. He said, that's where the painting is. He wanted to buy it back from me for 200,000 takas, which I refused. Whenever I'm talking to business students about investing in art, I always give this as a very important instance of why they should be buying art. Norway and Emma, who we all wanted, who we absolutely idolized and wanted to grow up to be like her. This is a work of hers that is in Lahore. It is with the son of the person who purchased it, who was a doctor, Dr. Riaz. It's not in very good shape. This was photographed for my book that I did on women artists of Pakistan. I was not able to interview Novera because she was at that time living in Paris and was a recluse. She was pretty much a recluse when she was in Lahore also, but would be at every exhibition, at every concert, at every public event, and she made her presence felt. This is a work called The Angel, and there's another work which is in my collection, which I inherited from my parents. Done in 1960. At the inaugural of the National Gallery in Islamabad, we loaned these works from Lahore. They were part of the opening exhibition in 2007. I think there is a realization that when we talk about art in Pakistan, it is essential to talk about the work before 71. Which was very much part of the sort of the influences, part of the influence which worked towards the development of the modern art movement in Pakistan. These are now in the public collection. The prints from the Gera, they're part of the permanent art gallery collection in Lahore. Printmaking certainly was very highly developed in Dhaka, and so consequently when the works would come in some of these exhibitions to Lahore, it was essential that they become part of the public collections, which indeed then they are on view for students to see. Safiuddin Ahmed, who was one of my personal favorites, this is also part of the public collection, permanent gallery in Lahore. And it's on view, not in great shape, I'm sorry to say, which seems to be the fate of all government collections. I don't know how it is there and here, but certainly in Pakistan, they seem to suffer from neglect. Yes. And this is one of Zainul Abidin's works, which again is in the public collection in Lahore. It's another one that I have. And this also. Some private collection in Lahore. This is from my own collection. Yeah, this is just over to you.
Thanks so much, Samima. I think this, these works from Lahore and from Sajuna's collection gives you a sense, I think, of the kind of exchanges that were, taking place before 1970. So I just wanted to, in a sense, contextualize. Perhaps we can go to my presentation. Go home. Let's go one more. Okay. So what I want to say is that I want to focus on Zainul Abidin and then say a few words about the present. So the thing to the way I think of Zainul Abidin, I wrote about him a section, I've devoted a section of my book, which Modernism and Muslim South Asia, the art of Muslim South Asia, there's a section on Zainul Abidin, but I was very interested in his foundational role as one of the pioneers, as Sarina alluded. Okay, and one of the ways in which Zainul Abidin's practice, you know, is of course his own practice, but he's also working, you know, in a context of developments that take place in the larger Bengal region, right? So that includes the development of the Bengal school from the 1900s onwards. And of course, the experiments and the kind of relationships to the folk and to the tribal, okay, and to the vernacular, to the local that are taking place in the 20s and Shakti. Okay, next slide. And so here, you know, and in a sense that, you know, Dhaka does not have an art school. So right after 1947, Zainul Abidin proposes successfully and gets the, you know, and, you know, is the Dhaka Art Institute is founded. The architecture eventually is done by Mazhar Islam. Okay, and you know, let's go to the next photo, which is, I like this photo a lot because I think this exemplifies the almost the contradictory or the dual role that Zainul Abidin occupied. On the one hand, you know, you see him working as a principal or as a bureaucrat, if you will, surrounded by, you know, by artifacts and toys that he's gathering from kind of, you know, folk traditions of East Bengal, of East Pakistan. And this is actually something he, you know, as an educator and as a very engaged educator, okay, as the founder of the art school in Dhaka, but also the, you know, a person who set up the Department of Fine Arts in Peshawar University. Okay, that was his role as a government official, as an educator, as a bureaucrat. Okay, and he took that role seriously and in I would say in a very positive and enabling role. Okay, and there's a statement by the perception among sort of in West Pakistan was that that art somehow naturally flourished in East Pakistan, okay, and it had to do with you know, so there's a statement that I quote from an art historian from Pakistan who says that that the East Pakistanis were naturally endowed with art, whereas we in West Pakistan had to work hard to become artists, okay. And now I'm not endorsing that statement. I'm just mentioning it as a way to think about the perception that you know of art. And I think and one way to understand why that perception was there is to think about exactly the role that Shantiniketan and the Bengal school played in the development of you know of work that Zainul Abidin takes forward, and then an important role that he plays in terms of his own teaching in Dhaka, okay, but also in his kind of formative influence in Pakistanis society to think about, for West Pakistanis to think about their relationship with the folk, okay, which wasn't really the practice in Pakistani art education prior to that. Okay, so that's a kind of an important conceptual role that he plays, right? Okay, and of course there were all sorts of, you know, other exchanges that Salima also mentioned, that there's on the left is the artist Sadiqain, okay, at you know, at an exhibition along with Zainul Abidin, and the next photograph is you know, from the same exhibition. Both of these photographs are provided to me by Zainul Abidin, the son of Zainul Abidin, and I thank him for that. But we also have to understand that in a sense that the Dhaka artist or the Chittagong artists, okay, they didn't have, I mean, in a sense that there were economic imbalances between the two mains, right? So the galleries were in West Pakistan, the collectors were in West Pakistan. So the Dhaka artists and the East Pakistani artists wanted to show in West Pakistan, okay? And for that reason, if you want to write a history of Bangladeshi modern art, you can't not, you know, you have to, in a sense, address, you know, the collections that are lying in various states of, you know, neglect or awareness in, you know, in collection. I think that's an important art historical role that's transnational and that urgently needs to be done. Okay, now just a couple of words about the present, which is to say that, and this is what Farooq Subhan Sahab also mentioned, what is the future of South Asia in terms of cultural and artistic cooperation, right? And what is the role of, in the sense, art education precisely in doing doing so. And why can't we imagine a future like what you have in the European Union, for example? In the European Union, you find students from Italy studying in England, and you find, students from various countries crossing borders easily and studying at various educational institutions, going where their interests take them. Okay? And I think we need to have a kind of a positive enabling vision of that sort. Okay, suppose if Colombo has the best performance art department, then maybe an Indian artist student can go and study in Colombo and performance art, right? Why can't we have a kind of an enabling vision of culture, which Farooq Subhan Saab rightly, I think, stressed and is working hard to achieve, right? And the last, just in a minute, I was chair of the art department at Cornell University for 4 years. And one of the things I was in charge of admitting students, and I could have admitted students, we had hundreds of applications, right? I could have admitted all students from New York City, okay? Or I could have admitted the whole class of 30 from South Korea, okay? Okay, and they were all admittable, but we worked very hard to stress diversity. And diversity means social, economic, class-based, urban, rural, linguistic, national and international, ethnic, religious, sexual, etc. Right? And diversity is absolutely central to the training of artists, because you learn most from people who are different from you. Okay? And unless we, in a sense, understand the kind of formative and conceptual role that diversity plays in the formation of our intellectual and artistic trajectory, okay, we will remain confined within the limits of our own horizons, which are limited no matter which city or which country you occupy. So exchange is extremely essential for intellectual and artistic growth.
Just to follow up on what was just stated, what is an interesting teacher, and in recent years I've organized three, possibly four exhibitions in Karachi, Lahore, Islamabad, of Bangladeshi artists. And what is interesting is that even today, there are a number of people in Pakistan who collect Bangladeshi artists. I can name at least 7 or 8 contemporary artists of Bangladesh who are much sought after and highly regarded in Pakistan. As far as I'm aware, the reverse is not the case, and perhaps we do need to see more works of Pakistani artists here in Bangladesh.
Thank you. I think carrying on from what you said, we were lucky enough with this new university that was set up in Lahore, private university, so it's free from some of the trappings of bureaucracy. Since it's not in the public sector. But we were lucky enough to be recipients of these scholarships from the South Asia Foundation, which was the brainchild of UNESCO Goodwill Ambassador, the late Manjeet Singh, who felt that it was really through, at least for us in Lahore, through the arts to bridge many divides which are in South Asia. And for me, as the dean, I felt very strongly about having students from two countries in particular. I may not need to stress what they are. I wanted students from India and I wanted students from Bangladesh. And I was not able to swing in the first batch students from India, though we did get one and he wanted to study journalism and art. Perhaps he was smarter. But we were extremely lucky that in the first batch we had Aisha and Musarat. Musarat came to do graphic design. She's currently doing her master's in Los Angeles, and I met her in November when I was there. And Aisha came in the first batch and stayed on for an extra year after you graduated, didn't you? 2 years, stayed on for an extra 2 years. Yeah, we couldn't get rid of her. But it was extremely gratifying that they developed, I think, within a couple of years at the Beaton House National University, this group which had students from Afghanistan, from Bhutan, from Nepal, Bangladesh, and India, Maldives, Sri Lanka. Since they have graduated, they have formed their own networks. Some of them have been exhibiting together in venues very far from South Asia. But that bond has remained, and it continues to blossom, which is something which is tremendously, it's an inspiration for those of our generation who have seen a lot, including great trauma and much pain. And therefore, it reinforces one's hope that they will be the healers. Tell us a little bit about Aisha, your experience, and you know how. Well, firstly, how is Lahore? Did your parents worry about you?
Hello. Hi everyone. I initially went for my foundation year studies. It was a scholarship program, and then I ended up staying for 6 years. There was a lot of personal rootlessness when I went. I was about 18 or 19 years old, and my father was supportive, but then there was this, you know, anxiety about, okay, I'm going to Pakistan, but it's going to be for 1 year, so it's okay. And he was constantly in touch with Mrs. Ashton, who was my dean at the time, over email or over the telephone. But I think I went to Lahore with really like no idea about the art scene, the contemporary art scene. I was aware about Sadiqin and Shaki Ali and a few other artists, but it was an environment which was like really nurturing. And I'd like to just emphasize on what Iftikhar also mentioned just now about diversity. And I think for me, it was a really good learning experience because of the diverse group from the other SAC countries and the other artists, the other students who were present at that time. So we were also the first batch, so it was a very small group of about, I think, 25 students. And, you know, we just close interaction with all our professors, like Huma Munchi, Julia Ahmed, Rashid Jara, and also amongst the peers and our other classmates. So there was also a lot of like exchanges between the other departments, like the film department and the journalism and the, you know, other departments in psychology. So yeah.
Hello, everybody. My experience, like after getting a scholarship, when I spoke to my parents that I had a scholarship, and so where? In Pakistan. Pakistan? Yeah, Pakistan. And we had one family. So I had to face it verbally. All of my uncles, my father is there, and my youngest uncle suddenly spoke up. So okay, he got a scholarship, let him go. Then I left, and basically I shifted hostel to hostel, Dhaka University hostel to Vienna hostel. And over here I noticed people are, like students are coming from different districts, and there I found students are coming from different countries. And in the hostel, like, I got friends from India, Sri Lanka, all the SAARC countries, friends are like got over there. And the education system, what I got, that is, over here, it was one sort of education system I was going through, and there it was completely different. And nowadays, what I'm practicing is a blending of two education systems that I exit, and I don't know, it's you could decide that how this working in my art practice. But I have learned a lot from there. In the beginning, I of course I will say two persons named ma'am, I'm not taking ma'am Ashmi's name because he's everything. She's everything, sorry. She's everything. And another two personalities is Dr. Kanyev and Dr. Chandu. From them, basically, I learned a lot. And while I was working in last Dhaka Art Summit as an assistant of Mr. Mahmoodur Rahman, because he was taking care of experimental film and the performance. And I was assisting him. And Mahmoodur, one day he was saying that Shimul, do you have any person in certain countries who can send their experimental film? He said, of course, let me figure it out. Then I just knocked my SERC friends and I got 5 films from experimental film from there. So it's a good connection. Like, through this study system, through this scholarship, this submission on this scholarship, I got a good connected friend circle that were always next to me. And from there, I got 5 films and it was screened over here in last Dhaka Art Summit. And and yeah, it's a good experience over there. And another, that is, it was a great opportunity for me to travel a lot in Pakistan. I have been to Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Hunza, a lot of places. And I found that people are quite humble over there. And before going to Pakistan, I had a negative sense about it. But after being there, my sense became changed, completely changed. And still now I'm having to go again in Lahore. I do this.
Actually, I'd like for a moment for you to talk about your art making. You know, because after all, you graduated and there's been lots of influences back and forth, but your development, I think, has been quite remarkable. I'd like you to talk about the various influences you know, that you have sensed or you feel have developed in terms of the way that you're looking at your own work, how you critique it, and because it's intrigued me to follow your art after you've left Lahore. I'm interested in seeing how you feel it's developed. What's been happening with you is what I want to know.
I think during my undergrad program, that I was doing at Beacon House, there was a lot of confusion when I first joined because I felt superbly inadequate. Because my classmates were like, you know, especially the ones from, I mean, the other side countries as well as the ones from Pakistan, they were like highly skilled. And they had a really rich background in art history. So I struggled a lot in my first year. I used to also skip classes out of fear that I would not be able to, like, you know, do well, especially like something like sculpture. So I shy away from sculpture, from Huma's class. But some of the interests that I tapped into in my initial years is something I also keep coming back to, or I've come back to after my graduation. Also after my undergrad, I stopped making work for a few years when I started teaching at Beacon House. So there's always been this, interest in making things. Also, like, what was really, really, like, I think significant to my journey was the conversations that I had with my other classmates, other artists like Sanani, Meher Javed, Raju GC, just to mention a few. So I think those conversations were important because we were also like critiquing each other's work. And yeah, I think those were really important.
I'm just interested from where I'm sitting, like, you heard me talk about, you know, way back in history, in the last century, there were connections. between this part of the world and what is now Pakistan. Did you come across any of these connections? Did you feel anything? Was there any of that history in your experience when you were in Lahore? I never asked you this while you were there, you know. You know, the history of what was once one country, and you know, it's two independent nation states now. Did you come across any of those connections while you were there? Did they talk about it? Were there, you know, any sensitivities?
There were discussions, but what was surprising was my Pakistani classmates were completely unaware of the history or what had passed during 71, prior to 71. So that was really surprising that, you know, the textbooks and all the history was kind of, you know, like erased almost.
Did you talk about it?
I did. There were some, there were some arguments as well. So that was an issue.
I have lots of experience about it. Like from, especially the middle hostel.
You speak in the mic, please.
Yeah?
Yes.
Is it fine? In the hostel, when, like, if you did not something, we are talking about, especially during the cricket match. So, first question, that day it was Pakistan and India's cricket match was going on. So some Pakistani student was asking me, what are you supporting? I said, why are you asking? And he asked me again, which one? He said, why are you asking? What would make you happy? He was saying that, if you support Pakistan, I'll be happy. Then I'll support you. And he was not happy out of my answer. I was just watched the match and I led from that dining table. And that day was Asia Cup. Basically, that was the Asia Cup the Bangladesh played in the final match, like the first time, and lost in Pakistan. That day was very, only me and Chira was next to me. Chira was supporting Bangladesh. Chiranta, he was my roommate from Sri Lanka. So throughout the entire series, like most of the time, their question about, like, if I say that I hate India, they're so happy. They say, I like India. Oh no, man, you don't know anything. Then I ask them, what do you know? Do you know about 71? So what is 71? And I noticed that most of the people over there, the general people, nobody knows about 71. And over here, everybody knows what happened in 71. So 71 is a big question. Like over there, nobody knows. And over here, everybody knows. Then, question over here, that who knows? So then I started to talk to them, that what happened in 71 and what happened before 71 and what is happening after 71. And in the beginning, basically, they didn't believe at all. Seriously, they didn't believe. No, man, it is not possible. You see, it's possible it happened. This is data, I gave them data. And they started to learn that what happened and what. Basically, it was another opportunity for me to let them know what happened in my generation. Because I noticed in my generation over there, nobody knows. And I don't know my previous generation, how much they know. So, and another experience, most of the time, it happened, when Pakistan is losing the math is fixed. Math is fixed. Is it math? Then fix some match to win. Always new people fixing for losing. Why? you can fix some miss for win. So do that. Then you go, okay, no man, you don't understand. So okay, I don't want to do it. So every cricket match, basically, it was a great experience during my Pakistan time.
I think there's a moral to this story somewhere, but I'm not really sure what it is.
Yeah, so I think this is the question, I think, thanks, because 71 is, in the sense, you're absolutely right, that Pakistan 71 has been kind of whitewashed from, especially in the memory of the younger generation, they just are not aware, right? And when I came to Bangladesh in October and I saw 71 everywhere, it's very, it remains a very important, kind of foundational narrative that I think the Bangladeshis are still grappling with. Now, obviously, that, in a sense, this needs dialogue, at the very least. And, one of the things that, again, educational exchanges can do is for us to kind of, in a sense, begin that dialogue. And as artists and as art education, can also play a role in this, As well as, I think, another way to think about art education in a collaborative way is to think about our curriculum together. Have perhaps meetings and discussions about what's actually being taught in art schools in across South Asia. What is the curriculum for? What is the role of history and humanities and theory? In the training of artists. And how do these things come together and how do we talk to each other in a unless we if we remain in our silos? We will continue the. I mean, many great things have happened in. South Asia in the 20th and the 21st centuries, but many ugly things have also happened. So in a sense, if we aspire towards a better future, what is the role of us as artists and as educators in enabling that? I think that's the question that, that's the larger,
I think we should end on that note, that we look to artists, art educators, poets, filmmakers, music makers, who actually begin and step into the areas which we are all afraid to step into, because I think they carry with them the healing that is essential before you can commence and also continue dialogue. Thank you very much.
Collect Bangladeshi artists. I can name at least 7 or 8 contemporary artists of Bangladesh who are much sought after and highly regarded in Pakistan. As far as I'm aware, the reverse is not the case. And perhaps we do need to see more works of Pakistani artists here in Bangladesh.
Thank you. I think carrying on from what you said, we were lucky enough this new university that was set up in Lahore, private university, so it's free from some of the trappings of bureaucracy since it's not in the public sector. But we were lucky enough to be the recipients of these scholarships from the South Asia Foundation, which was the brainchild of UNESCO Goodwill Ambassador, the late Manjeet Singh, who felt that it was really through at least for us in Lahore, through the arts to bridge many divides which are in South Asia. And for me as the dean, I felt very strongly about having students from 2 countries in particular. I may not need to stress what they are. I wanted students from India and I wanted students from Bangladesh. And I was not able to swing in the first batch students from India, though we did get one and who wanted to study journalism and art. Perhaps he was smarter than what he was. But we were extremely lucky that in the first batch we had Aisha and Musarat, who Musarat came to do graphic design. She's currently doing her master's in Los Angeles, and I met her in November when I was there. And Aisha came in the first batch and stayed on for an extra year after you graduated, didn't you? 2 years, stayed on for an extra 2 years. Yeah, we couldn't get rid of her. But it was extremely gratifying that they developed, I think, within a couple of years, at the Big House National University, This group, which had students from Afghanistan, from Bhutan, from Nepal, Bangladesh, and India, Maldives, Sri Lanka. Since they have graduated, they have formed their own networks. Some of them have been exhibiting together in venues very far from South Asia. But that bond has remained and it continues to blossom, which is something which is tremendously, it's an inspiration for those of our generation who have seen a lot, including great trauma and much pain. And therefore it reinforces one's hope that they will be the healers. Tell us a little bit about Aisha, your experience and how is Lahore? Did your parents worry about you?
Hello.
Great.
Hi everyone. I initially went for my foundation year studies. It was a scholarship program and then I ended up staying for 6 years. There was a lot of personal rootlessness when I went. I was about 18 or 19 years old and my father was supportive, but then there was this, anxiety about, okay, I'm going to Pakistan, but it's going to be for 1 year, so it's okay. He was constantly in touch with Mrs. Ashton, who was my dean at the time, over email or over the telephone. But I think I went to Lahore with really like no idea about the art scene, the contemporary art scene. I was aware about Sadiqin and Shakir Ali and a few other artists, but it was an environment which was like really nurturing. And I'd like to just emphasize on what Iftikhar also mentioned just now about diversity. And I think for me, it was a really good learning experience because of the diverse group from the other SAARC countries and the other artists, the other students who were present at that time. So we were also the first batch, so it was a very small group of about, I think, 25 students. There's a close interaction with all our professors, like Huma Munchi, Julia Ahmed, Rashid Jara, and also amongst the peers and our other classmates. So there was also a lot of exchanges between the other departments, like the film department and the journalism and the other departments in psychology. So yeah.
Hello. Hello, everybody. My experience, after getting a scholarship, when I spoke to my parents that I had a scholarship, and so where? In Pakistan. Pakistan? Yeah, Pakistan. And very dry family. So I had to face a board meeting. All my uncles, my father is there, and my youngest uncle suddenly spoke up. So okay, he got a scholarship, let him go. Then I left and basically I shifted hostel, Nagar University hostel to DNU hostel. And over here I noticed people are students are coming from different districts. And there I found students are coming from different countries. And in the hostel, I got friend circle from India, Sri Lanka, all the SAARC countries, friends are quite far over there. And the education system is what I got. There is over here, it was one sort of education system I was going through. And there, it was completely different. And nowadays, what I'm practicing is a blending of two education systems that I exit. And I don't know, it's you could decide that how it is working in my art practice. But I have learned a lot from there. In the beginning, I will say two persons' name. Ma'am, I'm not taking ma'am Hashmi's name because he's everything. She's everything. And another two persons is Dr. Kanyev and Dr. Shabnam. from them basically I learned a lot. And while I was working in last Dhaka Art Summit as an assistant of Mr. Mahbubur Rahman, because he was taking care of experimental film and performance, and I was assisting him. And Mahbubari, one day he was saying that Shimul, do you have any person in SAARC countries who can send their experimental film? He said, of course, let me figure it out. Then I just knocked my SAARC friends and I got 5 films from experimental film from there. So it's a good connection. Like, through this study system, through this scholarship, this Salvation Army scholarship, I got a good connected friend circle that were always next to me. And from there, I got 5 films, and it was great over here in last Dhaka Art Summit. And and yeah, I mean, it's a good experience over there. And another, that is it was a great opportunity for me to travel a lot in Pakistan. I have been to Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, Hunza, a lot of places. And I found that people are quite humble over there. And before going to Pakistan, I had a negative sense about it. But after being there, my sense became changed, completely changed. And still now I want to go again in Lahore. I do this.
Actually, I'd like for a moment for you to talk about your art making. You know, because after all, you graduated and there's been lots of influences back and forth. But your development, I think, has been quite remarkable for you. I'd like you to talk about the various influences you know, that you have sensed or you feel have developed in terms of the way that you're looking at your own work, how you critique it, and because it's intrigued me to follow your art after you've left Lahore. I'm interested in seeing how you feel it's developed. What's been happening with you? This is what I want to know.
I think during my undergrad program, that I was doing at Beacon House, there was a lot of confusion when I first joined because I felt superbly inadequate. Because my classmates were like, you know, especially the ones from, I mean, the other SAARC countries as well as the ones from Pakistan, they were like highly skilled. And they had a really rich background in art history. So I struggled a lot in my first year. I used to also skip classes out of fear that I would not be able to, like, you know, do well, especially like something like sculpture. So I'd shy away from sculpture, from Huma's class. But some of the interests that I tapped into in my initial years is something I also keep coming back to, or have come back to after my graduation. Also after my undergrad, I stopped making work for a few years when I started teaching at Beacon House. So there's always been this, interest in making things. Also, like, what was really, really, like, I think significant to my journey was the conversations that I had with my other classmates, other artists like Sanani, Meher Javed, Raju GC, to mention a few. So I think those conversations were important because we were also like critiquing each other's work. And yeah, I think those were really important.
I'm just interested from where I'm sitting, like, you heard me talk about, you know, way back in history, in the last century, there were connections between this part of the world and what is now Pakistan. did you come across any of these connections? Did you feel anything? Was there any of that history in your experience when you were in Lahore? I never asked you this while you were there, you know. You know, the history of what was once one country, and you know, it's two independent nation states now. Did you come across any of those connections while you were there? Did they talk about it? Were there, you know, any sensitivities?
Yeah, there were there were discussions, but what was surprising was my Pakistani classmates were completely unaware of the history or what had passed during 71, prior to 71. So that was really surprising that, you know, the textbooks and all the history was kind of, you know, like erased almost. So, yeah.
Did you talk about it?
I did. There were some, there were some arguments as well. So that was an issue. Kind of
I have lots of experience about it. Like they're from, especially in the hostel.
You speak in the mic, please.
Yeah?
Yes.
Is it fine? In the hostel, when every dinner table or something, we are talking about, especially during the cricket match. So, first question that day, it was Pakistan and India's cricket match was going on. So some Pakistani student was asking me, what are you supporting? He said, why are you asking? And he asked me again, why are you, which one? He said, why are you asking? What would make you happy? He was saying that if you support Pakistan, I will be happy. So then I have to support Pakistan. And he was not happy out of my answer. I was just watched the match. And I led from that dining table. And that day was Asia Cup. Basically, that was the Asia Cup the Bangladesh played in the final match, like the first time, and lost in Pakistan. And that day was very only me, and Chira was next to me. Chira was supporting Bangladesh. Chiranta. He was my roommate from Sri Lanka. And so throughout the entire series, like most of the time, their question about, like, if I say that I hate India, they're so happy. And if I say I like India, oh no, man, you don't know anything. Then I ask them, what do you know? Do you have a 71? What is 71? And I noticed that most of the people over there, the general people, nobody knows about 71. And over here, everybody knows what happened in 71. So 71 is a big question. Like over there, nobody knows, and over here, everybody knows. Then question over here, that who knows? And so then I started to talk to them that what happened in 71 and what happened before 71 and what is happening after 71. And in the beginning, basically, they didn't believe at all. Seriously, they didn't believe. No, man, this is not possible. You see, possible it happened. This is data. I gave them data. And they started to learn that what happened and what. Basically, it was another opportunity for me to let them know what happened in my generation. Because I noticed in my generation over there, nobody knows. And I don't know my previous generation, how much they know. So, and another experience, most of the time, it happened, when Pakistan is losing the match, man is fixed. Man is fixed. He said, man, then fix some match to win. Always you people fixing for losing, why? Win. So do that. Then you go, okay, no man, you don't understand. So okay, I don't want to do it. So every cricket match basically was a great experience during my Pakistan time.
I think there's a moral to this story somewhere, but I'm not really sure what it is.
Yeah, so I think this is the question, I think, thanks for because 71 is, you know, in the sense you're absolutely right, that Pakistan 71 has been kind of whitewashed from, you know, especially in the memory of the younger generation, they just are not aware, right? And when I came to Bangladesh in October and I saw 71 everywhere, it's really, you know, it remains a very important, kind of foundational narrative that I think the Bangladeshis are still grappling with. Now, obviously, you know, that in a sense, this needs dialogue, okay, at the very least. And, you know, one of the things that, again, educational exchanges can do is to, you know, is for us to kind of, in a sense, begin that dialogue. And as artists and as art education, you know, can also play a role in this, okay? As well as, I think, another way to think about art education in a collaborative way is to think about our curriculum together. Have perhaps meetings and, you know, discussions about what's actually being taught in our schools in across South Asia, what is the curriculum for what is the role of history and humanities and theory, okay, in the training of artists, okay, and how do these things come together and how do we talk to each other in a, unless we, you know, if we remain in our silos, okay, we will continue the, I mean, many great things have happened in South Asia in the 20th and the 21st centuries, but many ugly things have also happened. So in a sense, if we aspire towards a better future, okay, what is the role of us as artists and as educators in enabling that? I think that's the question that, that's the larger, you know.
I think we should end on that note, that we look to artists, art educators, poets, filmmakers, music makers to actually begin and step into the areas which we are all afraid to step into, because I think they carry with them the healing that is essential before you can commence and also continue dialogue. Thank you very much.
That resolution is kind of addressed till the compounding problem of that relationship will always remain there. That was an observation. Question is, do we have some Pakistani students coming and studying in Bangladesh as an option as well?
When she was very little, a young lady, and her father is one of the greatest poet of Urdu in the subcontinent. And I had the opportunity to meet him several times. He used to come to my house. I lived in Rawalpindi for many years. And I met some of the artists that she had mentioned, Shakir Ali and Chuktai, of course, I didn't meet. But they're all products of pre-partition India, like Zanula Vidhi. I have a slight reservation about calling Zainul Abidin a bureaucrat. Zainul Abidin is an artist who was working for the government and was trying to establish an art school in East Pakistan at that time. And therefore, he had to do a lot of things which otherwise he would not have done. He has sacrificed really his life in art that he could give us today. You have shown some of the pictures, but I would have been very happy, Salima, if you could show some of the paintings of West Pakistani art, like Shakir Ali and Chuktai and Sadiq. And the last painting, Zainul Abidin was seeing, Sadiqain was standing there. Sadiqain is one of the great painters of Pakistan. The book I have at least 3 inches thick and about 18 inch high and about 12 inch wide. It's a very big book called The
Holy Sinner.
Huh?
The Holy Sinner.
The Holy Sinner, right. And you didn't mention about Zubaida Aga. She played a great role in promoting the art in West Pakistan. At the very beginning. And I happened to be there when in 1964, I started a gallery, commercial art gallery. That was the first commercial art gallery in Pakistan. And very few people knew about the Pakistani artists. They knew about the East Pakistani artists more. But today, I hear a lot of young Pakistani artists, they are doing very good work. The topic was the inter-border art history. And we should have concentrated more on comparing the artists' work, who are working here and who are working there. And Mr. Farooq Subhan was saying that he knows at least 6 or 10 people who are buying paintings from Bangladesh artists and that sort of thing. But the discussion went somehow in other ways. And I thought the discussion should have been more on the board.
Let me ask two questions that followed from, I think, the collective presentation. And one of those, I think, with Salima and Iftikhar's presentation, I wanted to ask about, you spoke a lot about the artists and their areas of geographic belonging, but I'd like to hear a little bit more about the language of modernism, the visual language of modernism, rather than, I don't know, maybe a more old-fashioned word might be style of what it is that we're looking at, and shared sensibilities, affinities, and disjunctions. The other question I had was related to Iftikhar's comment about South Asia becoming more like the EU, and I couldn't, I think, hope for anything more than more cultural exchange, but the fact is that Italy and France are not on the brink of nuclear war every few years, and so it makes for a very different environment. And I was struck by Aisha's comment about art history, to say that students are coming to art school with not just a very different sense of, actually both Shimo and Aisha's comments about coming to art school with different senses of history as, you know, political history and social history, but also art history. You said that you had been aware or conscious of the difference between your training in art history and that of other students that you've been with. So what really can we do, I think, in terms of thinking about platforms for thinking about, or creating platforms for thinking about the study of art history, and to create dialogue not just in terms of art practice, but in terms of an understanding of the past.
Just to make a plug for Cornell, okay, so I'm always looking for students to do their PhDs, okay, and we offer full funding. Okay, so please come in, you know, and not just Cornell, but there are other universities that, you know, and even if you're an English major, you know, who are interested in art history, you can come and study in the US in many institutions, and you can work in these really, you know, in a sense that many of these artists have had, you know, especially of the generation of the modernists that have crossed, you know, their trajectories, you know, are in, you know, Pakistan, India, Bangladesh, UK, etc. And to write those histories responsibly is kind of an urgent task, I think.
Well, I think thank you for being a patient and seemingly very interested audience. And I think that for us, at least, we take back lots of questions. And I think with a renewed vigor, we'll carry on this many rewinds. And I want to congratulate Dhaka Art Summit for providing this forum for us. It's extremely valuable, probably much more than everyone realizes. Thank you very much.